Angelos studied architecture in Athens and worked for almost 25 years, constructing houses and shops. He also specialized in light and design studies. Preferring to do everything by himself, he was mainly fixing on his own whatever needed to be repaired and also made small furniture. When he fixed everything around him, he understood that he had to start anything. Crafting for him was an inner need. Due to his work and passion for tools, he was familiar with techniques of many constructive professions. A friend taught him at the time how to make handmade knives. He started making knives. When he needed a very special silver saturin, he couldn't do it. He went to contemporary jewelry seminar to learn how to do it. There he found a new world he didn't know he was searching for. Guided by random paths of faith, here he is now.
Hello, I'm Haridini Karliafti from FaceArt. I'm responsible for art jewelry. We are here with Angelos Gostatakatos to have a talk and give us a better idea about his work. Welcome, Angelos.
Happy to be here with you.
Okay, so would you like to tell us, Angelos, how you started your relationship with jewelry? Was it something that you were always thinking about or came to you as a sudden idea? How did you get involved with jewelry in the first place?
Well, when I was studying architecture, I could never imagine that eventually I would be creating art jewelry. Of course, I was crafting everything around me, but never I was crafting something that needed to be repaired or to be fixed, not something just to create. I didn't understand at that point the joy of creation itself. I was also admiring old tools, and I started to collect them since I was 20 years old. And the first search in deep waters of crafting was when I tried to renovate all tools, to clean them, to repair them, but without losing the patina. So there were many materials involved, many tools, sandpapers, cleaning materials, restoring materials, and this together with the technique I was searching for when I was when I started to make knives, that led me to the seminar of contemporary jewelry. And from that point, it was something that, like, I always wanted to do it, but I didn't knew it. Something like that. So it was all the knowledge I had from crafting and from architecture, I mean the drawing, and the luck I had to go to a contemporary jewelry seminar.
It was magical, you could say.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, do you spend a lot of hours in your studio working on some pieces or experiment with the materials, with tools, shapes, colors?
It depends. It depends on if I have another architectural project running or if I have an exhibition ahead, or most important, if I am experimenting to find something I need. So I would say from 1 hour minimum to 15 hours per day on a 7 day per week basis, on 7 day, not 5 day. As about how much time I spend to a specific jewel, I cannot calculate that because when I start to experiment on a new material, I'm experimenting without actually creating a jewel. For example, mushrooms, when I started the new collection that is called Second Chance, I tried a new technique, completely new. Not technique, a new methodology, I would say. So I was creating mushrooms as a raw material, not a jewel, a raw material, for let's say 9 months without creating a single jewel. The result is I created over 300 mushrooms, and only 10 of them will eventually become jewels. Because
three out of 300?
10 out of 300,
ten,
yes.
Oh my goodness.
Yes, this is the way I work, because I don't know what I am searching for until I see it or feel it. So I create until something speaks to my heart. Okay. And at some point this happens, and then I know what to search for or what to try to create. But for a very long time, I don't know. I'm searching. And then if I see something better, I throw away the older one. I don't use it.
Okay, so the materials you used is mushrooms, as you said, seaweed fruits. How did you end up using these materials? Of course, I suppose it wasn't the first idea that came to your mind when you started creating your first pieces. It was not the first material you thought.
No, it was not. I chose silver as my first main material because I thought it was something precious, but at the same time affordable. And it was very nice to work with it. And I use it as only silver jewel, or I added wood or paper in several forms of paper. Then I added titanium as a metal that I like very much, difficult metal, but very interesting. And at one point I was introduced to resin. And then I understood that the possibilities of the resin are endless. And mushrooms came to my field of interest during a dinner with friends as a bet. I thought that if I could make a jewel out of mushroom, I would be a great artisan. So I started trying.
Experimenting.
Yes.
What is the process that you use with the mushrooms in order to make them jewelry? Is it difficult to...
Are you asking me to reveal my secrets?
No. If the process is easy or difficult. If it is time consuming or it is very easy to process it.
Okay.
The secrets are for you, not for us. Your secrets.
For the time being. The procedure is very, very difficult and time consuming. You have to be very patient to start create something with organic materials in general, but particularly with mushrooms, because mushrooms are very fragile, they are volatile, and they can surprise you. They have something to that you cannot have in mind. For example, it took me 2 years to find 2 years to find, not in general, I'm experimenting with mushrooms from 2014, over 5 years, it's 6 years already. It took me over 2 years to find out how to make a mushroom red or blue. 2 years. You would say, how difficult can this be? I don't paint my jewelry. I evaptize. I want the color to be in the mass of the mushroom, not in the surface. Okay. When you try to color a mushroom, whatever color you put, but in particular red or blue, it turns automatically to black. I don't know why, but it. I'm telling you, it took me 2 years to do that.
So you find the way to, you found the way,
I found the way to, yes,
to do that. Good, yes, for you.
You see, there is no, you cannot Google it or read the book how to do it. Everything I do, I have to find out myself. Mm. Whatever I think, I have to find it myself. I cannot ask anybody else.
You don't find tutorial videos on YouTube, maybe to give you some advice about.
No, I don't know anyone else but me to make mushrooms, to turn mushrooms into jewelry.
So you have to teach other people how to do that.
Yes. That's what I said at one point.
So do you have in mind to use some other materials in future? Although yes, you have already used a variety of materials, as you said before.
I have used a variety of materials, and I have many more to wait until I find the time or the energy to create something with them. Because if I change a material, there is a long period of experimenting before I know that I can do anything I want with the particular material. I have tested some and not be successful. I have tested some and left them for a later period, and I have collected many, and they are waiting. I don't know if they are suitable or not. They are waiting at another time. For the future, yes.
Yes, okay. What is more exciting for you in making jewelry? The shape that you imagine to give to a jewel, to a piece, or the material you use in order to create it?
I have a problem. My mind is very has a very particular way to work, to function. So I have to be in some way focused on something very specific, because I can lose it very, very easily. So if you give me one piece of metal, a sheet of metal, of silver, I know I can do anything. So I start to look at the silver and do nothing. Somehow I have to be motivated or inspired by something and form it into something very specific and start to work in this small area of the material or the draw. Okay, I can draw anything. I can create anything, but what can I choose from all this? I can choose anything. So I start, I don't do anything, and I start looking, not doing anything. The mushrooms and other organic materials, but especially the mushrooms, have a will of their own. Mm. It doesn't matter what you want to do. It matters also what the mushroom wants to be. Okay, so what I do, I have a communication with the material, with the mushroom, for example, and we go together doing and seeing the result up to a point. We go together. I don't do what I want. I do what we both want, what the material tells me that wants to become. And until a point, at that point, I take charge and make the jewel I want. All this, transaction helps me to be at a very specific range of working. This helps me. So the material helps me find the shape. I don't know which is more important. I think the way I work with the materials I work, it's a combination of both.
But mostly you start from the material, I think.
Yes. I don't make a draw and then create it. I start working, and at a point, I have the image or the draw, or I know what to do. So, but I don't know from the beginning what I want to do.
Yes. So the material gives you the inspiration.
Yes.
Okay.
This is not the way that most artists work. I know it's not what many do, but I cannot function otherwise.
Okay, it's personal, I suppose.
Yes.
So a general question with the situation we live this year. COVID has caused great changes in our everyday lives, in our work, everywhere. So we, as a result, we have a diffusion of chats online, classes online, training online, exhibitions online, in our case. And you participate in the first exhibition online in Greece this year in Athens Jewelry Week. I would like to give me your opinion about exhibitions online. What do you think about them? Do you think that maybe it's a chance for a lot of artists to participate since they are more affordable, they have less expenses, and maybe it's a chance especially for young artists to participate in online exhibitions, and maybe it's a challenge for different trends in art to communicate, to interact. What do you think about that?
Well, I'm a Pisces as a zodiac sign, so I can understand the flow of the world. I understand that this time it is a very, very difficult time that we are all living in. But eventually it will end. I don't think that what we are living now will be the way of life for the rest of our lives. And as I always do with everything around me, I think we should take the positive points of this situation, which is the easy way to communicate with all around the world, with everybody, and it becomes so common and affordable, and it doesn't surprise you. It doesn't. You find it easy to start a Zoom or a Skype
talk.
Communication. Yes, talk. So as you say, this will help new artists. I didn't thought of that before, but it is very correct what you say. Young artists with less budget to have the opportunity to take part at an exhibition in Tokyo or in New York. Who could afford to go to Tokyo or to New York? But in a digital exhibition, it's very easy to do. On the other hand, I don't think that you can outrun in any way the feeling that you have when you go next to the jewel and see it, or to talk and to shake hands, or to kiss your fellows creators on an exhibition that you visit in life. So I think we should keep the good parts of the current situation, but also not forget what we did until last year.
Yes, like you said, nobody can underestimate the importance and the positive impact of the physical exhibitions, but people and the world moves forward, and we have to adjust to the situations, to the given situations each time. So we'll see what happens in future, because they are very hard times.
Yes, they are.
Anyway, yes. So, and very provocative. So we'll see what happens in future. Thanks for being here and having this talk together. I wish you all my best with your work.
Thank you.
Okay. See you in Athens Jewelry Week.
See you next week.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.